Hello.
John, can you kill the music? Thanks, John. Hi, everybody. Yeah, that's right, I'm Carl. Welcome to world, you know, New York City. All right, so, you know, grab a seat. I'll give everybody a few moments to do that. It's great when you take a seat. Grab a coffee, grab a donut. You good? I can.
Hello?
I'll just do this, actually. This is easier. All right, so World IAD 2016, New York City, thank you very much. Hopefully the live stream is working, and if you're not here, you can see this and maybe hear it. All right, so the first thing we're gonna do is, you know, it's an important thing. We have a code of conduct, be good to each other, but it's essentially that there's me, there's some volunteers, there's also a global support team. If you think anything has gone wrong, at the event today, if you feel like something inappropriate happened, the email address is safety@worldiaday.org, and you can view this code of conduct, which is a little pixelated on this screen. You can view it online on 2016.worldiaday.org if you want to read up on what we're doing. Okay, so we're here for World IAD. What is that? It's a international celebration of information architecture. it takes place locations all over the world celebrating information architecture, or IA, right? So it's a great question. What is, you know, 1,800 members, 76 countries. The people that run it are great. They look like this. Fifth year we've been doing this. Again, we're all over the world. You know, North America obviously has many cities doing it, but as a country, we're well represented. But like Beirut, you know, there's stuff, it goes on everywhere. All right.
Filled with information. Whether it's figuring out what bank to use or bus to take, whether we're watching the local news at home or working in the studio on the latest app, information is pervasive and affects everyone's life.
Six continents, going anyway. Our first speaker today is Jared. Come on up, Jared. We'll get you set up. Jared's great. We love Jared. You know, he's been doing this for a long time. It's not that he's old. He's just been doing it for a long time. And, you know, he does great stuff. He's got a great talk.
We'll notice that from this talk, I bet. This is a lot of effort to get this stuff together, so there are volunteers in the back. Give them a round of applause, I think. Yeah. New York City, and I went to a lot of museums, and it largely informed my path into information architecture, so I'm really excited to be giving this. So, about art, we're going to dive, which is a really interesting work of information. Cool, because Frank Lloyd Wright made a lot of decisions in this space that had never really been made in other physical museum spaces before, like a startup story. So there's a lot of just general lessons about, you know, running a digital business that can be culled from here as well. So, like I said, it's a personal story for me, and this is kind of where it all starts. This is Computer Camp, circa 1983. I'm, it, To this day, that is a feat of engineering I have done, I think. And then not too long after that, I was a really bad teenager, and my parents had to send me away. I was a really bad teenager. And they sent me here. This is Storm King Mountain. Storm King Mountain's known for three things. Perfectly fine. Right down the road on the other side of the mountain, Harry School might be next. And the third thing it's known for is this place. This is the Storm King Arts Center. And this place blew my mind. This was one of those like teenage experiences where I'm like forming my view of the world and like I don't get here and I don't really understand what's going on. Because like I said, I grew up in New York City. One of the things that happens when you grow up in New York City is on a lot of field trips, because it's a museum, it's a city as a classroom, and there's world-class museums everywhere. So by the time I got here, whether I was aware of it or not, I had a about 30, 40 feet high. They're enormous. It's really, as content, as information, it's really radical. It doesn't fit in the context of what I thought a museum was. It doesn't fit contextually, and it doesn't fit physically. This is this giant pasture that's 560 acres. By the way, if you're about an hour to go do it, it's totally worth it. The environment that it's in is turns out to be just as radical as the content itself. It's huge. It's imposing, and it's dynamic. It's kind of hard to see here, but what's going on here is, I'm going to say this is probably late spring or maybe early fall. So what happens is the ground cools overnight, and then the sun comes out and warms the air, and the cool ground creates this fog effect that starts to creep across the mountains. And this equally crazy environment that has this sort of tension between it. They're sort of fighting for attention. So for the purpose of this talk, I think it's useful to think of art as information or content and museums as the interfaces through which we access that content. So this is a really radical interface for really radical content. Here's another piece. This is a favorite. This is Menashe Kadishman. Easily fit underneath that thing, and it sits in the middle of this long pasture. And just for a sense of scale here, like, so there's people, they're in the foreground. They're probably 20, 30 yards from, and then like you look further back, that's like another 50 yards back, and that thing looks bigger still. Like these pieces are gigantic. The largest piece I think is about 90 feet tall. It's this tension. They understand space is actually part of the content that they're producing. And many of them begin to start to really break down the boundaries of what that means. So this is not Vietnam Memorial. This is. So they're kind of the same thing, but in this case, we're looking at this from an angle here. Works is you pick an area of focus. Your senior year, you spend 6 months museum marketing and acquisition strategy and climate control and curatorial techniques. Museology is really the is it the number of pieces? I don't know, it doesn't really feel like a museum. There are buildings at the Storm King Art Center that have galleries. Are those museums? I don't know. And then it gets into things like, what are the ethics of running a museum? What are what's a museum's role in society? Right, but rarely do they say, we're not really sure if this is a real piece or not. That's not really what they do. And I sort of walked into this field, and I think how we're presented with museums growing up is they are sort of these hallowed spaces, right? They are sort of the arbiters of culture, and they sort of preserve what is the best about our society. And when I really got into studying the field, that turns out they're not the case, that these are actually highly political organizations with agendas, and they're but frames, and the reason for this is that these are the rooms that house the French painters, and this is by design. There is a secret, or maybe not so secret, nationalist agenda at the Louvre, where they want you to walk away thinking the French painters are the best ones. Anybody know who this is? No? This is Vasily Kandinsky. This is the artist that really serves as the cornerstone to the Guggenheim. And he's doing some really interesting thinking. This is all. And the whole thinking behind this movement is grounded in this sort of quasi-spiritual religion called the. And then you carry this out into the world. And this is some pretty heavy thinking for the early 20th century. And there are some parallels between that and the work we do, I think, right? So this is a very linear view of, probably overly simplified view of the field of experience design, right? Where we have users at one end and devices with interfaces at the other. And kind of the space we're all really interested in is like the space in the middle here, right? So that may be our medium and these may be our audience, but this is what we're really designing, that stuff in the middle. And if you apply an information or a content layer to that, the stuff that sits behind the interfaces, we end up with something like this. And it's not a big stretch, you know, to see it, for frame it as a in the museum context as well, right? But as I said, this is kind of overly simplified. More recent thinking says it's actually a little bit more like this. There are tech philosophers out there. This guy Peter Paul Vierbeck, who's very interesting, and they work in the field of phenomenology and something called mediation theory, right? Which is what they're talking about, what he would, in this context, what it would mean was that these things, it's not actually this linear progression of person and content and interface, and that what's actually happening is that all these things operate in an ecosystem. They all affect one another. So the interfaces we design and the way we organize information to create experiences are not, do not sit by themselves. What they really are doing is mediating our relationship with the world. And because they're mediating our relationship with the world, they are actually creating the world around them. A more simple way of saying this is that information and the context that it sits within can't really be separated, right? This is Vasily Kandinsky again, composition number 8, this is. And so he has this idea that by designing, by creating these works of art and by having people view them, that he's gonna resonate people's souls and they're gonna leave the experience of looking at his art and they're gonna go make the world a better place. It's kind of a romantic vision, actually. And like I said, so this is a startup story, so let's talk about that for a little bit. This is Hilary Bay. Hilary Bay is sort of the unsung hero of the Guggenheim Museum. She's actually kind of a bad. I want her to be a proper young lady, and instead, she's running off to Berlin and to Munich, a non-traditional way for the for the. Cubism has really hit its. Mixed up a lot of things. So the first thing he did was whitewash the interior, so now it's bright white. Check this out. See over here? The paintings aren't sitting flat on the wall. He doesn't get the whole 15-degree thing. He thinks it's weird. That's not how you do art. That's not how you do museums. So he did his best hack as he possibly could, and he pushes them away from the wall. So he stops to prop them up. This is what he does. They sort of end up floating in space. It's really kind of strange. Here's a picture from the side. And the critics agree. They think this is totally ridiculous. Here's a quote from John Kennedy, who's the New York Times art critic of the day. The experience is a battle between art and museum in which neither wins, but both come out badly maimed. It's pretty damning stuff. But they get past this. They start to install things properly. But there are still content problems, because the next wave of artists are painting these huge canvases. So Abby Covert, in her book, which has lots of great little nuggets, has this saying, ambiguity costs clarity and exactitude costs flexibility. She's talking about taxonomy here, but taxonomy, as we all know, is very frequently how we navigate digital spaces, right? And I think it applies here, right? So this is an ambiguous, unclear, but really flexible space, but it's not at all sympathetic. Whereas this is very exact, very clear, totally inflexible, and very sympathetic to the kind of content it's trying to illustrate. And the artists that are coming up are painting on these huge canvases, these color field painters like Barnett Newman and Jackson Pollock. And these are really kind of appropriate to the theme of the museum itself. I mean, they're all trying to capture something expressive and push it outward. I mean, here's Mark Rothko. I mean, Mark Rothko is squarely in the religious space. This is one of my favorite art quotes, right? Of course, the flip side is that constraints also create some interesting opportunities. This is Alexander Calder. This is one of his mobiles. I don't know that one of his mobiles has ever been more effectively displayed. Without an environment like this, you couldn't like really get on top of the mobile or see what it's like from the side. Like, to me, this just like works perfectly, and you can't experience this kind of information unless you're in an environment like this. Here's Jenny Holzer. She's well known in the 80s for like doing these really provocative digital messages that sort of slide along, and she's asked to do an installation here, and she winds her messages around the rotunda. Again, you can't really design something like this unless you have a structure like this. This is James Turrell, who's known for creating these sort of environmental and immersive contexts. And what he does is he puts a canvas over the roof and he projects sort of the inverse of the rotunda up there. You sort of sit there and you're like, whoa, and there's fog going through, and they do scent so you can actually smell. He creates this experience, not really possible any other way. And then the museum evolves. They get a series of acquisitions. This is 1963. They get this collection called the Thanhouser Collection, which is a very important collection. They don't have a spot for it. So they take the small rotunda, which was originally designed for office spaces, and they sort of start tacking up art in there, and it's not really working so great anymore. And then they've got to repair it. So this is around 1989. There are serious structural deficiencies, as you can see. And then they build this addition right here. So this is how it exists now. The art world freaks out. The art world says, what is this? This was our beautiful gem at the side of the park, and they've put this back on it, and now it's the toilet bowl of the city. It's totally unfounded, because Frank Lloyd Wright had actually designed pretty much exactly the same thing in 1943. One of the big critiques of this space, of the addition, was that it was now blocking the city from behind it, but Frank Lloyd Wright hated New York City. There's a reason there's only one building here. He's perhaps infamously quoted as saying, there is no real architecture in New York City. So the guy who's in charge of this is this guy, Thomas Krenz, who's just a total D-bag. And his commission immediately prior to this was MassMoCA, which is the Massachusetts, the Museum of Contemporary Arts up in northern Massachusetts. And his idea for that was to turn it into a giant shopping mall for art. But he oversees the expansion. They kind of follow the same formula with Bilbao, Spain, and it totally works. It transforms the region. And then they go too far. Anybody remember this? This was down in Soho. This is the Guggenheim in Soho. Now it's a Prada store, which is ironic because I think one of the last exhibitions they did was a Prada exhibit. It goes bust by 2001, and here we're definitely too far. We're down the rabbit hole where you've got the Guggenheim in Las Vegas at the Venetian. Sort of gotten back to their core mission. This is Abu Dhabi, slated to open 2017, and to me it looks beautiful. This was entry. I think it's open now. So if you go to IXDA, I think is in Helsinki this year, you can go visit the Guggenheim, it's there. So what do we learn from all this? One, build alliances. Hilla was like this masterful person who like got all these really high power people involved. This is a photo called Hilla and her dogs, because there are actually dogs in the picture, but her dogs are actually Kandinsky and Ferdinand Lerger, who were like two of the most preeminent artists of the time, and she had them at her side, like helping make decisions. So to that I would say, if you're in a large organization, form alliances. The structure is more important than the particulars, right? He didn't give up on the rotunda. He knew he wanted this space, but when he started to fight about color, he said, okay, right? Your context matters. So this is Storm King Art Center again. Now we're looking at it in the fall, right? Now what happens, again, with this kind of with the interface at the Storm King Art Center, like in the fall, it's totally different. They're bright red. You can go in the winter after when this thing is a snow field. The whole thing is bright white, and you can there's snow on the art. Like it completely changes the way you think about it. And I think really what we're saying is that the context matters, right? It's not just about organizing information. That's not enough anymore. This is IKEA's catalog from 2014. This is practically stale by now, but like they understand that like an object in a catalog isn't as meaningful as the object in your home. So the Guggenheim really is to expand and become this really this iconic multinodal global art organization that is really unparalleled in the art world. And at the same time, we need to challenge the embrace your constraints. Again, I think the constraints of the museum lead to some of the best work that's out there, and I think the same can be said for, you know, these devices we all hold in our hands or on our wrists or on our jeans nowadays, right? Is that when we work in these strains, within these constraints, new opportunities emerge. And finally, have a relationship with your information space. This is an app that a friend of mine does space, and then when you're back in that space, you can revisit it so that the thing always lives in context. It's not just about having the object in your phone anymore. It's about having it available to you when you revisit that actual space. And that's it. Thank you very much.
Thanks, everybody. And thanks, Jared. All right, and
on it's very important to describe persons with disabilities that way. It's really the appropriate terminology. There's one word, handicapped, which should not be used. Many people with disabilities hate that, especially people who use wheelchairs. For example, handicapped parking, handicapped restroom. It's better to use accessible bathroom, accessible parking. So that's much better language to use. The reason why I use the word handicapped, that was from long ago. People would beg for money. People would have cups and beg. But it really gives the impression that people with disabilities are poor or need other people to survive, and that's not true. Another word is suffering from a disability. People who have disabilities do not like this term. We're not suffering with a disability. We're suffering from, we don't have a problem with our disability, we have a problem accessing things in the world. A physical barrier can be removed, but an attitudinal barrier is even more difficult. And it's sad because it's a medical point of view, it's a very pathological point of view. So we need to change our view in society from a medical point of view to a point of view that puts the person first. Another important point is that disability does not discriminate against anybody. Some people are not an elderly person, I might have to experience that, but it could happen to anyone. Family has any deafness or disability at all. But when I was 2 years old, you would think I'm just an average person. And it's true, a disability for anyone, even wealthy people. Maybe you've seen the movie The King's Speech, and that's about the father of our current Queen Elizabeth in England. And he had a stutter, and that was his disability. And the queen's husband's mother was also born deaf, who was elected 4 times. He used a wheelchair. And in that time, no one even knew. He was not born that way. He didn't grow up with a disability, but he contracted polio, and that's when he had to use a wheelchair. Helen Keller is another example. She was deafblind. She got sick with scarlet fever and became deaf and blind. And also, Richard, he has a learning disability called dyslexia, but he is one of the most entrepreneurs, and many of you party group in the world. 1 billion people, so that's the size of China, with $4 trillion in the market. So obviously, they lose. Businesses need to do more research. Out more statistics about this. They find out statistics about gender, age, and other demographic information, but they need to do more research to provide accessible services and products. For example, Target. Target was sued millions of dollars, and that's a lot more expensive, providing captioning for their streaming services. American Airlines travel. So there's a lot more examples. And we have laws here. We have web accessibility. Now, maybe you feel like you really want to make your product and service accessible. But you think, who's responsible for this? Is it the coder's responsibility or the developer's responsibility? Really, it's everyone in the team's responsibility. Coding will have to follow some of the international standards. For example, writers and editors and content people who do content strategy need to follow these guidelines as well. And that will improve the user experience for everyone. Visual designers need to make sure that there's color contrast, and like I just pointed out in my first slide. Also, in terms of user experience, we have these categories, and it's good for people working in UX know about the standards, but that's not enough to just check it off the list now of a page that has potential accessibility issues. Now, many websites have accessibility issues. I can't discuss it all in depth, but I'll show you 2 examples right now. First, we have CAPTCHA. That's a problem for people who are blind. It's not just people who are blind, but it affects the user experience for us all. I'm not blind, but I often have frustrations with CAPTCHA. The letters are very distorted and difficult to understand on the form. Accessible. Valid. Chats or video chats. Someone has a difficult accent to understand, it could help you understand too. Maybe you notice with my voice, it depends on the environment. It could be a noisy environment and the caption can help. I am involved in UX and user experience, and often there are... Okay, so now you understand here, okay, but no one asks, hey, are there captions? Does everyone understand? So when you host an event, you need to make sure that there are captions available, and you shouldn't wait till someone requests it. Many people don't want to ask for services. I encourage anyone who's having an event to have open captioning. And you can have an announcement and say, we will have an open captioning at the event like you see here. And if you need any additional services, to please let me know. Sometimes people will request an interpreter or wheelchair access. Events need to make sure that they pick a place that is also accessible to people who use wheelchairs. And speaking about employment, that's a big barrier for people with disability too. They will have a diversity and inclusion objective to include focused on diversity. If I apply for a job, I have to decide whether I disclose if I have a disability or not disability. Sometimes there's a person with no disability and low qualifications, and a disabled person with high qualifications, but they're rejected. So it's best to hire someone who has the best qualifications. And if that person has a disability, they might have great ideas to contribute, and there'll be a real benefit to the company. I've had that frustration myself a lot. During interviews, I have to let them know that I'm deaf and I'm rejected straight off the bat. Or I'm invited to an interview by an interpreter. That's Nelson Mandela's memorial school and work. Luckily here at the that was something that I experienced, bad interpreters. But I also went to a wedding, and a friend hired interpreters for me. So when I was comfortable providing services and accessibility for only certain things. It should be open for show up. You can't smile in the bookstore and have the books be converted into Braille. So a smile when you have a disability and showing a good attitude is a really frustrating message. Plus, frustrations at everyone that you might feel in. Last weekend at the Grammy Awards, Stevie Wonder, who's a blind musician, was given the envelope to announce the winner. And he was laughing. He was like, ha ha ha, you guys can't read the winner. It's only me. About the physical events and educational events. So I want to thank you very much for listening. I provide accessibility consultants in terms of user experience.
All right. Thank you very much, Veta. And if you stop by during the break and leave your business card, we'll be doing a drawing for a copy of her book. So, you know, if you're interested in that, she'll be over there by the captioner. And so next up, we have Loren. There he is. All right, so, what? No, I got it on here, if you're ready. In fact, look, there it is. All right.
Hello. Good morning. So I'm going to talk today about conversational architecture, which is an approach to describing contextual applications, circumstances. So just give a brief introduction on who I am. I'm actually not an information architect. I'm a tech guy. And I founded a company 5 years ago called Axelent. And we make a product called ACE, the Adaptive Context Engine. And basically, it is a technology for enabling contextual applications. And by that, I mean applications that respond according to the specific context in which they're presented, having knowledge of the users and responding dynamically and appropriately to that. But it's not an ad, so I'm not going to talk more about ACE. Oh, and additionally, before that, I ran technology at Huge. It's a digital agency here in New York. And before that, at Alexander Interactive. So out there. And just for proper attribution, I did not come up with this list. This is from a book called The Age of Context by Robert Scoble and Che Israel. And they're talking about primarily technological and sociological forces that are existing today that are driving us towards this idea of the importance of context within applications, be they websites or mobile apps, or things that we don't know about yet, new form factors, new devices, new interactions. And, you know, here's a couple of ones that we know about right now. That's the Amazon Echo up there with the Alexa. So, Alexa, please order me 500 rolls of toilet paper. It shows up at your door. And, of course, Siri and the iPhone. And you know, I think what we probably can expect is more and more of these are going to appear over the course of the year that respond appropriately to that. Age of computing moving from a box that sits on top of your desk into something that is, you know, following you around in your back pocket and onto, you know, things that you wear, maybe things that are embedded in devices you interact with. All of this, sort of hop around here. With those devices come sensors. Sensors of motion, of light, things that, you know, look at your eyes as you read, things that monitor your heart rate, see whether you're excited when you're, we know all these things. Social media, the greatest data honeypots ever created, where we voluntarily tell all about ourselves, who our friends are, what we're interested in, what we're doing on a regular basis, how all these things connect together. And finally, location. When computing moves off your desk and into this permeable environment, it lives in a particular place. And so me standing on the stage in this room implies a certain amount of context as to what I'm doing. Just by, you know, if you could pinpoint this down to like these 3 feet, you have a pretty good idea of what my context is right now. All of this stuff combines together and creates context. And going forward, we're going to need to be able to build for it. Unfortunately, we don't have a good way to talk about it. This is the Rosetta Stone. And right now, there's a situation where, you know, you can talk to a bunch of tech people about artificial intelligence and talk about a lot of concepts there. You can talk to business stakeholders about, hey, wouldn't it be cool if we could build these things that would react contextually to the users? And then there's this kind of void in the middle where we don't have a good way to talk about the design of these applications. And this creates a problem. First thing is, it's just hard to discuss the problem space. Or what a language to be able to clearly articulate how these things should work. And of course, all these things. So what I'm going to say is we're actually missing what I call a bootstrapping metaphor. This is ripped off when he visited Xerox PARC, took it back, and built the Mac. And it's obviously super primitive by today's standards, but the metaphor is already there. There's the windows, it's a little pixelated on the screen, but there's the windows, the icons, the menus, pointers. It's the beginning of the desktop metaphor. And once, how do we build this thing in terms that stand on this platform of an application? There are several attributes of the network that actually work pretty well for our problem space. A stack of context that follows a conversation as it moves from one place to another. And finally, conversations are multi-channel. You can have a conversation that takes place on the phone, over email, face-to-face. A single conversation can bridge from one channel to another. You can move from one to another. It's the same conversation. You know, oh, this is getting hard to type. Let's go voice. Well, actually, this fits pretty well. This is what we multi-channel. So given this, let's and so let's say visual expression, language, or cave language. And the idea is this is a visual design language for communicating about contextual applications. And basically, there were three areas of concern. I once had these as layers, but I realized things are not that clear. So for the language itself, number of goals. The first one is whiteboard slash napkin slash fancy presentation friendly. So when we're describing this, just go and write in my terrible handwriting, you know, an idea about how it ought to behave on the whiteboard. Or it could be part of this lovely deliverable that would go out to the client. Secondly, methodology neutral. I think at this point in time, we actually don't know the best way to build these things. I think it's okay to admit that. And so this is a language. It is not the way you design these things. I think best practice is just starting with a way to talk about it. Create very simple ideas with this language, but also you could create very extensive, very idea. And finally, useful across disciplines. I think what is critical as we enter this world is that whether you're a developer or user experience person, information architect, a business stakeholder, that we're all able to talk together about how these things ought to work. And so the idea of cave language is it would be something with which you can create artifacts to pass around to people from different backgrounds, and everyone can be on the same page as far as what we were talking about. So here's a look. So, let's have a deeper dive. The first area of concern we wanted to look at was data. What does the application know? So we have our data symbol up here at the top. Now, data does not spring into existence out of nowhere. It has an origin. It is of concern to us where this data is coming from. So the rest of this has to do with the origins of data. So we have device sensors. Sometimes there are multiple sensors per device. Sometimes a device and a sensor is the same thing. There's the idea of an external data source, and this just means some other system is providing the data. And then there's a very special kind of data, which is user input, where a user is explicitly telling us something. And so we might make a construct like this. From Facebook, we are getting your likes. Now we know what you like. So once we have this, so now we've got that data, what does it mean? And this is a structure, somewhat ironically, called pages analysis. And it is based on dividing context up into these elements that comprise the overall context of the interaction. So we have persona, and I know a lot of different meanings are attached to that word. But for our purpose, personas have to do with something we know about the personality of the user we're dealing with. They are compulsive impulse buyers. You know, they like to buy things on the drop of a hat. Affinity. What do they like? What are they interested in? Goals. What are they trying to accomplish at this moment? The environment is a big idea, which is like, where is this interaction taking place? iPhone or whatever. It could be that it's raining right now. And sentiment, what is the emotional timbre of the interaction? You imagine someone working their way through times where we're making inferences based on data and extracting context that this person is or we know something else about them. What can we do about that? Now it is dynamically and appropriately to the context that surrounds the user. And so, like the context into elements, we're going to break down the idea of modal response. A way of speaking, it could be just any sort of policy is a little more of an abstraction, saying, well, we're not going to talk about specific content. User. Heating system. So this is a set that when the temperature drops below a little bit, they really feel it. That's my email, and I welcome input. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much, Loren, and thank you, everybody. So it's a break. You can take some time to get up and move around. There are snacks on the way. We'll see what happens with those. But in the meantime, I want to take this moment to, well, let me bring the slide up because there's too many things to remember. You know, this whole thing is a free event made possible, first of all, by our generous global sponsors, including Envision, who have some stuff back here. They're great, great application if you don't know about it. Look into it, look at their stuff, it's great. And there's a lot of the sponsors have given us things to give away. We're gonna be doing the giveaways in two part, one at the end of the break and another at the very end. It's going to be lots of fun. Thank you for all them. As you saw when you came in, O'Reilly is giving away a free digital copy of the latest edition of Information Architecture book. great stuff. And also, of course, very special thanks to our local sponsors. VSA is here. They are back there at that table. You can go say hi to them in the break. They have a wonderful little video running about the projects they work on. Great company. We thank them very much for supporting this event. And of course, ADP. We are in the ADP Chelsea event space. So that's why we can all have this event here today. So thank you very much to them. And there's the official thing that says break. All right. About 25 minutes.
I'm a developer, they're not spelling things out. And in general, it just really sounds like somebody's talking directly to you. One of the things I often hear when I talk to companies about being more colloquial is, oh no, that's not our voice. That's not really our brand. Colloquial is too playful for us. But what they're misunderstanding is colloquial is not about that. It's really just about having a conversation. There's nothing unprofessional about the tone here. It's just a nice colloquial conversational tone. So let's contrast that with a really famously bad example, iTunes agreement. Nobody knows how to read this. Nobody has ever really gotten through this. But there's a lot that's going on here that's not working, but one of the things I want to focus on is the all caps. Everyone in this room has probably seen a legal agreement in all caps before. Why do they do that? I'll talk about that in a little bit, but first off, all caps are really hard to read. And second, if this is a conversation, doesn't it look like they're screaming at us? So why are they yelling? Because someone told them they have to. It's not because they wanted to, I'm sure. No lawyers out there really angry with their customers, but someone told them they had to. And I'll talk about that in a minute. So what goes wrong? We can all agree that clear colloquial content is better for our users. We have tons of great web writers nowadays that know how to create this. But getting that content through the review process is not as easy as it seems. So this is how we typically imagine the content process working. There's some brilliant content creator who creates this like perfect piece of content. They toss it over to their maybe like two or three reviewers who are like, perfect, maybe you missed a comma here, but don't worry about it. They toss that down to the dev team who's like, okay, perfect, fits our patterns, this is great, it'll take us a day, we'll stick it in. And then the user's like, hooray, you gave me everything I wanted, thank you. I don't think that sounds too familiar. So how it really works. Content creator tosses over content to their like 40,000 reviewers, and this is in my experience, this is not everyone's, but particularly at a large organization like Amex, there's marketing, there's brand, strategy, product, there's that one guy who loves the word synergies. Everyone has to have a say in this content. So they take a look, like 3 weeks later, the content creator hasn't heard anything back, so they're nagging. Finally, they get back like 10 or 17 different files. Everything is completely conflicting. Synergies guys, like, there's no synergies between this and the marketing content. Marketing's like, this isn't our brand, the voice is all wrong. Legal's like, here's 17 more disclosures you need to fit into this tiny little experience. So back to the content creator who's like, okay, how's this? And the reviewers are like, okay, we fixed it for you. Like, maybe that goes back in three or four different rounds. But finally, they come up with something that doesn't really look like how they started, but we'll move on. So down to the dev team, who throws their hands in the air, and they're like, should have talked to us. This is not possible. Everything you just created doesn't fit our system. We're going to have to re-architect half the platform if you actually want us to get this live. So back to the weary content creator, who bends over backwards, last minute deadlines, try to fix things, tosses it back. Dev team's like, okay, we'll make this work. And our user's like, what the hell? It doesn't make sense. It's somehow redundant and missing key info at the same time. It sounds like it was written by 10 different people, because it probably was. And it doesn't represent anything that went into the initial content. So let's talk about how to make it better. I'm going to talk about three different periods, but at first, I think it's really important that you start by working with your reviewers from the planning mode of your projects. So this is an obvious one, but I see this overlooked all the time. At the very beginning of your project, take some time to list out everyone that's going to need to approve your project. So if this is, you know, maybe a couple stakeholders, work with those stakeholders to make sure that there's nobody that they need to have. You know, a couple times I've had this example where, you know, we're just to the finish line and we're right about to deliver something, and all of a sudden I hear, oh, well, we just need to run this by our, like, really opinionated VP first. And you're like, ah, it was so close. So make a list, check it twice. I think the big thing to keep in mind is that we have different kinds of reviewers that have different things they care about, and we need to work with them in a little bit different ways. There's, of course, a ton of different types of reviewers, but I think of them in three kind of overall groups. First, there are the people who care most about what you say and how you say it. So this is like, what is the actual content you're saying? What's the voice you're using? These are people usually in like marketing, editorial, strategy, product, brand, things like that. They're the folks that care most about protecting your company from things like fraud, litigation. These are often our lawyer friends, compliance, risk, fraud. And then there are the folks that really care most about the experience, design, and build. So if we're lucky, we work on a team directly with them. And these are our fellow designers and developers, fellow IAs. So I know everyone's schedule's hectic, but at the very beginning of your project, take time to meet with all of these people. It's really important that you kick off the project with their concerns in mind. In these meetings, it's really important to share your project goals and timelines, how you're going to work with them, and that's not just to review content, but actually how to create it, and I'll talk about that in a minute. What type of feedback you need. This is a really big thing, and I've had a lot of success with this. Just as we don't look to our copy editors to provide us legal feedback, we don't need our lawyers to be line editing our copy. It's really, really helpful if you can gently position this as, you know, we want to save you time and energy. We've got our bases covered with all of these different reviewers. Just please focus on this, and you can pass along your approval for this thing alone. Uh-oh. Sure. Okay, and we're back. And also, of course, it's really important to talk about any major changes. So if something you're proposing is actually going to radically change the experience that they're familiar with, air these out right now so you can talk about that with them. These pre-flight meetings are also really important to ask questions, learn about their timelines and review needs. Some people might have really long timelines for turning around content reviews. They might even have like a formalized process that they require you to use. And also talk to them about what you should keep in mind. So for example, if you're redesigning an experience that is heavily regulated by the government in an industry that's, you know, like financial services at Amex, you might have some things that you really absolutely must do that your reviewers have no control over. Are there technical limits in this channel? Are there any things that you should use as well? You need at least 2 rounds of reviews for your content. I would say 3 or 4 expect. When you're making your timeline, think about how long it really truly takes to create excellent content. Think about how long it's going to take your reviewers to review that. Think about how long it's going to take you to edit and then send it back a second time. And then like double or triple that time we'll expect. And it's the number one that throws out timelines in the end. All right, so now that you've set things up properly with everyone, you're into the meat of the project, you're doing your discovery and your design phase. It's really important that you don't work in a vacuum. I think you should avoid this by working on your content with all of your different reviewer groups, but in the different ways that suit each reviewer type. So let's start with the people who care most about what you say and how you say it. So these people are those folks in strategy, marketing, brand, et cetera. Before you do anything else, check to see if you guys are all in agreement about the variance over things like, oh no, that's not really our brand, we don't say things like that, or we have a particular way we have to say this line. If you don't have guidelines, it's a really good time to think about spinning off a project to create some, because this is going to come up again and again and again. Once you know what you're saying or how you're going to say it, I really recommend running a series of workshops to build a messaging matrix together. This is going to be the best thing you have to go back to in your reviews over time. I usually start a messaging matrix workshop with a brainstorming session. So we'll get everyone who cares about what that content is in a room, including my developers and my designers that I'm working with. And we brainstorm every potential message that needs to come up throughout this experience. From there, I'll take that away, and I'll group them into similar groups, and I'll create an empty, probably Excel spreadsheet. It's not pretty, it doesn't need to be fancy, with all of those messages across the top. So let's take a look at what that might look like. You've got all your messages across the top, and you've got all of the different places it could appear in your experience down the side. Hold a second messaging workshop with all of those same folks, and put tick marks in all of the boxes where a message should take place. Get everyone to agree on it. And then, before you leave, prioritize it. Because one of the biggest things I've run into is folks who think we can have 7 different prioritized pieces of content in a single email. Can't do it. And it's really good to have your designers and developers in the room with you to help make sure that people really understand why that's not possible. So once you settle on this matrix, you know exactly what's prioritized and where, print it out and bring this to all of your reviews, because then people aren't going to come in last minute and say, oh, I was really expecting us to cover this here. Everyone helped contribute to what we need to cover here. You've got some really good divergent views in the room to get you there. And now you have an artifact that's going to hold you to it. The next step is to create and share page tables. If you're not familiar with page tables, they're a really good tool, not only for your reviewers, but also for you as a content creator to help you get over that blank page syndrome. So a page table can look like this. It's also not very fancy. It's going to, at minimum, cover things like what part of the experience is this, what's potentially like a page title for that, what is the overall message we want to convey here, and then what are the different prioritized content pieces here. So we're moving from that messaging matrix into our content, and this is going to be a deliverable we get approval on from all of these same folks, and we're going to use this to make sure that when we're actually creating our content, we're keeping ourselves honest. We agreed with everyone that this is what this experience needs to do. This is going to help our designers and developers as well. All right, so let's move on to co-creating with people who are focused on protecting the company. Unlike that last group, these folks are typically a little bit less interested in actually creating the content with you because schedules are busy. There's typically not so much content that concerns them that they need to create it with you. So I find that if we have an experience that is particularly in their wheelhouse, maybe we're redesigning a form that's heavily regulated, maybe we are looking at just simply rewriting some terms and conditions, it's best to take a stab at it and then hold a workshop with these folks to review it. Inevitably in this workshop, you're gonna come across a lot of pushback. These folks, you know, bless their heart, typically don't come from user experience backgrounds, and you guys might be coming at things from divergent points of view. When you wax and wane to them about the importance of user experience, a lot of times I'll find, although this was not necessarily the case at Amex, but I've found in the past that lawyers don't really care. They're like, well, that's great. You know, of course we want the user to have a good user experience, but ultimately we need to protect the company. So do your homework. Start thinking about, if that's what they're concerned about, how can we find out what issues might arise out of protecting our company and not helping our users at the same time? So here's a good example I like to point to. The many times that Apple has been sued for having terrible terms and conditions. A lot of times, people in other countries particularly have found issue with, I think, their Apple's EULA in particular, which is impenetrable. It's a good reminder for our legal partners that just because they think we're in this ironclad situation full of legalese, we're not necessarily safe. So back to our old friend, the disclaimer. They're yelling at us in all caps. So why are they yelling specifically in all caps? It's because in something called the US Uniform Commercial Code, which a lot of lawyers use to create some of these documents, they have something called terms being conspicuous. So certain terms must be conspicuous if they're exceptionally important. So bear with me, I want to walk through what that means. So the Uniform Commercial Code defines conspicuous as meaning so written, displayed, or presented that a reasonable person ought to have noticed it. Conspicuous terms include the following. A headline in capitals equal to or greater in size than the surrounding text, or in contrasting type, font, or color to the surrounding text of the same size or lesser size. And B, language in the body in larger type than the surrounding text, or in contrasting type, font, or color to the surrounding text of the same size, or set off from surrounding text of the same size by symbols or other marks that call attention to our language. So this is, in the bold text, what our lawyers are seeing. I read this, and this is what I see. We have a lot of options here. And it's really good to look back to our friends at plainlanguage.gov who say, it's very difficult to read sentences in all capital letters because it's unnatural and the normal visual cues are missing. A short header is readable in all caps, but anything more strains the reader. Consider these other methods of highlighting important information: boxing the information, changing type size or font, using italics, or a light screen. But hey, those are all options within the Uniform Commercial Code. By doing my homework, I've found that there's a more creative answer that is completely compliant and is actually far more user-friendly. So again, the main point there is do your homework. Really look at what they care about and appeal to their concerns. You're going to have a lot more luck getting to the same thing that you guys both want together. And lastly, it's really important to co-create with people focused on your experiences, design, and build. So your fellow IAs, UX and visual designers, and developers. This is a no-brainer. lucky enough that my team was structured in a way that we were really all put on projects together and expected to collaborate from the beginning. Nobody worked in a vacuum. I know in a lot of situations people are forced to work in a vacuum. I highly recommend getting your team together, checking in daily with everyone, whether that's over the phone, more importantly, in person if possible. Having your designers and developers attend your reviews, attend your content workshops, be that voice of reason, be that expertise that you really need them to be. A great way you can help these folks is working with real content as soon as possible. So we all know, hopefully by now, that lorem ipsum should never exist in our experience. It's a terrible way to design because basically you're going to be designing for nothing. A big part of this is thinking about content as sketches. You can, from a page table, start writing something. I don't care if nothing that you write at that moment actually ends up in the real experience, but if you're creating something that your designers and developers can work with, it really is indicative of where you're going. It's got a little bit of the voice and tone in it. It talks about the actual content, the actual information you want to convey. It's going to go a much longer way in helping your developers. So just a reminder, no lorem ipsum, no a big title or intro copy headline. This doesn't mean anything. And work with real content from the very beginning. All right, so you've created with all of your reviewers in mind. Now it's time to actually review your content. What do? It's really important to create consistent review processes and tools. So by tools, I'm talking about the ways you deliver content. There are really two that I use right now, and I've found success with in American Express. In particular, delivering your content in situ with the designs, whether we're talking about a prototype, a design comp, but actually having your content pulled in there, or a copy deck. And that can be something like maybe a Word doc, better yet, a Google Doc. The pros and cons to reviewing InDesign, it best mimics the overall experience, so folks have a really easy understanding of how that content's going to work. It's not easy to comment on, which is great if you don't want comments. So maybe you're just trying to get design review, you're trying to get the overall feel of some high-level content, you don't want anyone copy editing. It also takes more time to update, which is a con. You know, if you have your designers and developers working on more important things, you don't want to be asking them to constantly update the button copy. And it's not easy to comment on, which is a bad thing if you do want that low-level feedback. In general, I would recommend reviewing your content design if you want high-level feedback, if you want to support your copy deck, or if you simply just don't want that low-level feedback in the moment. And for a copy deck, it's really great for track changes. This is a really important thing. When I see copy delivered in stuff like Excel or PowerPoint, I go crazy because your reviewers can't provide feedback that's going to be easy for you to interpret. You're going to get 16 different documents back. You're not going to know how to do anything with that. With both Google Docs and Word, there are great ways to combine all those comments in one place, and you can see how different people conflict and help them see that and work through some solutions together. It's, of course, easier to maintain than a prototype or a design file. But unfortunately, it's really out of context. So if you're delivering a really content-heavy experience without any sense of design, people aren't going to know what you're talking about, and it's going to create a lot of confusion. So I recommend using these things hand in hand if you can. Lastly, have a consistent review process. So there's a lot of things to think about here. Hold some in-flight reviews. Don't work in a vacuum, as I said. As soon as you start getting some content, throw it over to them. Get some early feedback, high-level feedback, and then you can definitely incorporate that. Schedule your final reviews with a lot of things in mind. Of course, if it's content heavy, give them some time to look at it beforehand. Make sure that they come to your final review with with comments in mind. Hold your meetings in person if you can. This is something that was really successful for us at Amex, is to get everyone together, whether in a room or on the phone. If you do it on the phone, make sure you have screen sharing software so you can pull things up and everyone can be on the same page. And don't do anything longer than an hour and a half. It gets really, really dry for folks. Bring cake if you can. Hold multiple reviews if you have to. When you start your final review, remind your reviewers the kind of feedback you need. That's everything from high level to low-level from you. And during the review one thing at a time. Don't overload people. Try and find solutions live together. This is good for when you get something that seems kind of impossible feedback. It can help people understand your thinking process and where you came from if you actually kind of put the feet to the fire and ask people to start thinking about things together. Treat your reviewers like the experts they are. You don't want to be online for getting your company sued. So make sure that you let them tell you the expertise that they have. And if you're hesitant to that, they're going to start thinking of you as a cocky jerk and nothing's ever going to get done. And know where and how to push back, but you can also be firm and flexible. So you are the usability expertise, and come prepared with your stats, your user research, some of your favorite quotes that are going to help support that. I found that goes a really long way in reviews. All right, wrapping up, in general, if you can't meet your deadline, don't expect your reviewers to meet theirs. They're not going to be the ones that are going to make up time for you. And cultivate positive relationships with them. Be friends on the side, get to know them, help them understand your expertise better. Just respect in general will always help a review go. And if nothing else, like I said, just to summarize, work with your reviewers to both plan and create content, consider your different types of reviewers, and be really thoughtful and consistent in how you share work. I want to close with this really lovely quote from Nicole Fenton and Kate Kiefer-Lee from their book Nicely Said. Keep in mind that feedback is a gift and not an insult. Thank you.
All right, excellent. Thank you very much, Lindsay. And now we have one more. Do 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 do. Yeah. Ooh. Did you? Wait, let me see. Let me find it. Hana, did you copy it over, or did you just open it from the drive? What is it called?
I put my last name in it, so yeah.
Ah. All right. Do you want both mics, or just going to use one?
Hi, I'm Hana Schank. I'm here with Kristine Malden, and we are from Collective UX, which is a user experience and information architecture consultancy that I have been running for the last, I think that's because. Sorry, small technical details. Okay, so we're from Collective UX, small UX and information architecture consultancy, and we're going to talk today about doing IA in the real world. So usually people will come here and talk about their successes and things that went great, but we decided to mix it up a little bit today, and we're going to talk about some projects that didn't go quite as planned. Why might we do that? So as we were thinking about the projects that we've worked on and over the past decade, we were talking through the ones that really stuck in our mind, and we kept coming back to projects that had just kind of not gone the way that we had anticipated them going. And as we thought more about those, we realized that they all boiled down to four challenges. So what we're going to talk about today are four challenges of doing IA in the real world and how to overcome them. So the first challenge, no one knows what you do. Or, dude, where's my sitemap? So the first job that I had where I was hired to be an information architect, it was a billion years ago, and I didn't know what an information architect was, even though I had been hired to do this. I'd been hired by somebody who was starting an IA group at a large ad agency, and she was the director of information architect and information architecture, and she needed an information architect to direct. So that was me. So I went to Yahoo because Google didn't exist yet, and I typed in information architect to find out what I was supposed to be doing. And I didn't get much. I got Richard Saul Werman's book had come out like the year before or something, so I got some information around that. So I started this job, and I was like, I don't totally know what I'm supposed to be doing. Like, I kind of been doing IA before, so I'm just gonna keep doing that, which was mostly looked like putting stuff in PowerPoint, like arranging some stuff how I thought it should be. And I got there and they had Visio, and I was like, oh, okay, I could do it in Visio. And so I started showing up at meetings, and I would get there and people would have no idea why I was there and what I was supposed to be doing. And we were all kind of confused together. But after a while, I sort of sorted it out and had some sense of, you know, why I was there and what I was supposed to be doing. And I thought, this is probably temporary. I think, like, you know, maybe in 4 years, we're totally gonna be running the place. I mean, everything should go through IA and UX. And so, you know, that's just a matter of time. So it turns out not so much with that. So don't assume that just because you're in the room, people know why you're there. What was true for me then is still true. Some possible reasons you might be in the room could be someone said, I need to get me one of those UXIA people. I need a sitemap. I need wireframes. I need this crappy thing to be less crappy. I heard there's like someone who does that, who's like a UXIA person, so let's get one of those. All right, so I'm gonna talk through a project that we worked on recently where this really came into play. So we were brought on to work with, we're cool now. So we were brought on to work with an agency that had branding expertise, and they had been hired by a large university. This is Oxford. It was not Oxford, but it was kind of like Oxford, but in this country. So this agency that we were brought on to work with had never worked with, they didn't have any UX or IA people on staff. They, it was just not a thing they did. They had kind of a more of a branding focus. And they had been asked by this university, not Oxford, to fix their site. They had this site that hadn't been touched in 7 years. It was super messy. People couldn't find anything. If you wanted to find out what the requirements were to graduate and you were an English major, what you did was you went to Google and you typed in the name of the university plus English department. So it was bad. So we went, they said, well, we have a week of user interviews planned and we're all gonna go up to campus and hang out for a week and do these user interviews. And so we get up there and we spent a lot of time like soaking up the atmosphere. We went and like bought t-shirts. We went and like drank beer and had burgers at the local pub. And we didn't play Frisbee, but like we saw people playing Frisbee. And we kind of never really talked to users. So they had these meetings set up and we would show up to the meetings and they would have a room full of 20 people. And they would ask everybody in the room to go around and say one sentence about what they thought the site should do. And these were their user and slash stakeholder interviews. So about midway through this process, I went to the guy who was running it, who was the head of the agency, and I said, so these aren't really user interviews, and I feel like we're kind of missing this opportunity because we actually could be talking to people, we could be kind of organizing this in a different way, because like we're really, you know, feeling the vibe of this university, and that's really going to help us. And you know, we're like, well, what do you think is going to come out of this process? And they said, well, you know, you're going to do a, like a reorganize the site and it'll be fine. And I said, well, I just, you know, want you to understand that we kind of have limited basically be us. So we came back to New York and we were like, okay, well, we don't have a lot to go on, but this site is super, super messy. So, you know, just with us in a room, we can certainly do something. So we did this. And we also did a competitive audit and kind of looked at what did other university websites look like. And, you know, there was some very obvious stuff because obviously, you know, we'd been university students and we had been there at a week and we'd gotten something from the users. So we put together a whole bunch of documentation, did an affinity diagram and a sitemap, and we brought it to the client. And the client being the branding agency, the marketing agency, and the client was like, okay, so a few things. So one, we'd like to present two sitemap options, because when we present our creative, we always present like, and we're a little concerned by that. And then they said, and the other thing is this nav doesn't really tell the right story. And we thought, well, we thought we were telling the story that this site was easy to navigate, so that's confusing. And they were like, but you know what? Map and reworked it and made three different sitemap options, and they called one bold, and they called one standard, and I don't remember what the third one was called, but in the end, the client wanted bold, because why would you not want bold? I feel like I could do that myself. So this was a client we were working with who just had not, they hadn't done it before, they hadn't been through the process and what we needed to do our job. Have clear conversations about the way forward. So we were not all on the same page about what was gonna happen with the user interviews. We should have had a conversation with them about what are you really hoping to get out of this? What's the real goal? You know, what are we expected to produce after? And totally been all on the same page and had some sense of what the purpose was of being there for a week. If the client has a plan, finally, if you agree to do a sitemap with no inputs, be clear on what that means and the limitations. So we are very often asked, you know, in a perfect world, we get to talk to users, we get to do the research, we get to do all of the interviews and the strategy and the really meaty stuff, but sometimes you just get asked to do a sitemap and you need to be 100% clear on, if I'm just like, just me in a room doing some heuristic stuff, here's what that is gonna look like. Always offer the best UX approach even in the face of adversity. So, one of the things that came out of our week of hanging around on campus eating burgers was that the university wanted to showcase their research. So they felt like this redesign was an opportunity for them to say, hey, we're a big research university, and we want to put that like all over the site so people know when they come that we're producing all of this amazing research. But the reality was that if that was actually what they wanted to do, we should have then taken that and said, if you really want to do research, let's get some findings around research. Let's talk to people about you know, who might want to access that and find out how do they want to access it? How are they going to find it? Are they realistically going to come to a university website and be like, gee, I wonder what interesting new research this university has come up with? And I will say here that in my other life, I am also a writer, and I do rely on a lot of research, and I have never, ever thought, I need some research, let me go check out these 10 university sites and see what kind of research findings they have. And I worked on a website that had research on it. Beyond that, you know, we could have said, I'm not just your sitemap monkey, I have other stuff that I bring to the table. So again, offering the best approach, regardless of what you're being asked to do, saying, okay, I understand you're asking me to do X, but there is also Y and Z over here that we could be doing, which is gonna get you much better results. So, which brings us to the next point, which is no one knows what they need. So, we're not in the room because everything's going great. Usually there's a problem and no one knows how to fix it. And often the stated problem has nothing to do with the actual need. So it's our job to get to the bottom of the problem. It's often the case that what people think is the problem isn't actually the problem. Sometimes people know, but sometimes they don't. So here's a story about that. So we were hired by a marketing agency to work on a strategic direction for a large West Coast hospital group, which was not this hospital. And that request came in, and it looked something like this. They wanted UX design strategy. And when we asked them, like, well, what do you mean by UX design strategy? They said, well, we want to do some usability on the existing site. And then the more that we talked to them, we kind of came to the conclusion that that wasn't actually what they needed. We realized that this was a really good opportunity to do some customer journey mapping, because what they wanted to do was create a completely new digital experience. And we were like, okay, well, you know what? You have a lot of touch points. You have your hospitals, you have your doctors that are in your group, you have pharmacies. Let's take a look at how all of that is working together. And you know, that's going to get you to a digital strategy. So we did some work with the client to create some kind of rough personas to recruit on, and we flew out to the West Coast to do these interviews, and we thought we were going to hear just these stories of, like, my throat was sore, so I went to the doctor and I got some penicillin and now I feel better. And we did hear some of that, but we also heard these gut-wrenching stories of people who, you know, would say, I went to the hospital with my daughter and I thought she was gonna die. And people in the interviews were crying and we were crying. And these stories were so compelling that they really illuminated a whole range of opportunities for us. And the original thing that we had brought in to do was really focus on, even though they said they wanted a digital strategy, their main focus for the marketing group was the hospital website. And so we started asking people, do you ever go to the, you know, when you're going to the ER, did you ever think of going to the hospital website? Is a ludicrous question. So what we realized was the whole focus of this project was wrong. You know, they were thinking about how are we going to tell people, like, the hours for the parking garage, and we're hearing stories that are like, you know, people coming in and saying, you know, I went to the ER and the doctor told me that I had cancer and I didn't hear anything that he said after that. And what we realized from that was that there was this information need that was everywhere. People didn't know where to park for the ER, but they also didn't know what they were supposed to bring to the hospital for procedures. People kept saying, well, they told me not to bring anything, so I showed up at the hospital and I didn't bring anything, and then they said, well, where's your checkbook? And so they couldn't pay. Doctors were giving people these diagnoses and then following it with, you know, you have cancer and blah, 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 and nobody was able to process that. So we were realizing that there was this huge opportunity to push information out to people that they needed that was going to make a huge difference in their life. And we're hearing all this in these interviews, and we're crying, and everyone's crying. And the marketing team, which is sitting behind the glass, comes back at, like, midpoint through these interviews and said, but what are we going to do about the navigation? So we were like, you know what, we're gonna get to that. There's gonna be navigation, but, like, what we're hearing is so much bigger than the navigation. So just a few things that we found. We, like, did this whole trust need quadrant. We're, like, putting together all these documents about, like, how the longer the people are in the system, the less they trust their doctors and the more they're going out to do their own research. We're doing all this customer journey mapping. We're, like, making recommendations around sending text messages and sending emails. And we present it to the hospital group. And the hospital group loves it. The hospital group is like, this is so awesome. We totally understand our customers in a way that we hadn't before. They're like referring to, you know, they're talking about the stories over lunch that we were telling. They realized that when they looked at our customer journeys, they said, you know, every single one of these starts at urgent care and we're not in urgent care. Maybe we should be getting into urgent care. So we're like having a great time. And then the marketing group comes back and says, how is this gonna play out on the website? Because they were really still focused on the website. That was their, they kind of couldn't, they didn't see the value of the journeys. So they wanted a sitemap, even though one of the findings was that nobody went to the website, but they were like, well, we still gotta do this website. So the end result was we gave them a sitemap, and they were like, yeah, we're gonna bring someone else on to do the wireframes. Okay, so what could have been done differently there? Understand who your client is and what they're really asking for, and then move them towards what they need. So when the client told us they needed a UX design strategy, we interpreted that to mean a digital strategy, and we went forward. But what they really meant by that was that they wanted a sitemap for this hospital website, and kind of regardless of whether people went there or not. So one thing that we could have done was to run a working session to try to illustrate the benefits of the work that we were doing. We could have said, you know, we did these interviews, here's what we heard, here's why that was so valuable, and you know, here's what we think is the way forward and why we think this is so much more impactful than a sitemap. We did do that in conversations, but we didn't really sit down with them and do it formally. Document, document, document. So I don't think that the agency had a good idea of what they were gonna get at the end of all of this work. They knew that they were gonna get something called product is gonna be, how does that sound to you? Again, we'd had these informal conversations where we did that, but we could have, but communicating on paper is always a lot more effective. And at the end of the day, some people are just not gonna get it. So in the case of the hospital group, what the end client needed, the end client being the hospital, and what the marketing agency needed were just two totally different things. The hospital group really wanted to hear about their customers. The marketing agency really just wanted to redo their website. And in part, that's because one of them was very brand focused, being the marketing agency, and the other was very customer focused. So that brings us to our third challenge, and I'm going to turn it over to Kristine for that.
Hi. So that brings us to the third challenge. If they don't know what you do and they're not sure what they want, they're not also entirely sure they want your opinion. It's easy to lean on familiar priorities like branding when you're not sure what else a UX person can bring to the table. We're referring to this as the brand user divide. It can be small, it can be big, but sooner or later, unless you work for NASA, you're probably gonna have to deal with it. And then I thought, well, you know what? Probably actually even if you work for NASA, you're gonna have to deal with it. And I found all of these articles about NASA's branding strategy. So, what do we mean by this brand user divide? It's the disconnect that happens when the stories that we tell about a brand are more important than the people we're telling them to. All the things that we come up with to instill trust, develop loyalty, instill confidence, create desire, all of these things become more important than the end audience user. It can feel like yelling, it can feel like indifference, or just plain wrong, but what comes across most of all is that it's not for you, it might be for nobody, and it's just plain bad. So it can be all of these things, branding, big brands, small brands, red brands, blue brands, new brands, old brands, but today a lot of things are branded that weren't branded a few years ago. So things like universities and government institutions and hospitals, But most often, I think we encounter this problem with older brands that are brick and mortar focused, and they're trying to transition into the digital space. So they're trying to adapt what has worked so well for them in real life to something online, which is a medium they don't fully understand, and they have a lot of expertise to bring to the table in terms of years and years and years, decades potentially of experience in real life, but they don't know quite how to adapt that. This is particularly true also in this age of omnichannel where everybody's talking about creating a seamless digital experience across all touch points. So it's almost like if publishing something in the digital space would make it so. Kind of in the example Hana gave with the university, they weren't really a research university, they weren't known that way, but it was almost like, well, if we put this in the navigation as one of our three main points, well, maybe we'll kind of like dupe everybody into thinking this is actually what we're known for. It's kind of like a wish that you could reach from beyond the glass and kind of change reality to fit what you'd like it to say. Does that work? Well, I think it kind of does, because it kind of gives your users an impression of what you think your priorities are. It can't transform reality, but it can modify perceptions of that reality and thereby tell stories that need to be told. But ultimately, users are smart. And your brand is what other people say about you when you're not in the room. So what do you do when you find yourself on the wrong side of the divide? Well, first of all, don't think of it as a divide. Think of it as a continuum. It's not an either or, there's no right answer. There are shades of gray. You can pick your most important battles and give way on other ones that are less important. So I recently worked on a project with a brick and mortar retailer who had a very strong mission statement. They were actually great. They were eco-responsible. They had been for way before it became cool. And they had this like ginormous seal of eco-responsibility approval in their brick and mortar locations. It was projected, it was really large, and the branding guidelines said that this seal always had to be within the consumer's line of vision throughout the store. So of course, you know, you get online, you're like, okay, we need to translate this, it needs to always be within our line of vision. So they wanted to have like a watermark on every page, they wanted it to be in the top navigation, they wanted it to be super duper prominent. They wanted to replace it with like some very important proactive calls to action. And I said, put it in the footer. Eventually we sort of came around to that compromise because it really had no place in the digital space. Nobody was gonna read it. The type was too small. It was great for print. It was great for projecting like 20 feet tall, but it was not great for a digital experience. And eventually that was the compromise that we came to, was that we put it in the footer, we made it nice and big and fat, everybody could read it, and it was on every page. They weren't crazy about it, but it was a compromise that worked. So another strategy is to get involved early and often. And I've heard this from a couple of other speakers today. It's much easier to present a valid solution to something when you know the stakeholders' business, where they're coming from, and frankly, if they've just seen you in the room often and they know your face and they trust you, it's a lot easier to make recommendations. Leverage tools to help move the needle. So we are lucky enough to have lots and lots and lots of UX and IA tools in our tool belt, and you kind of have to be willing and ready to pull out whatever works in the moment. So statistics are great, user journeys are great, user testing is great. We recently did a design studio, which if you don't know it, it's where you get people across an organization from all different disciplines. So you might have a developer and a designer and like a stakeholder and a marketing person. You make little micro teams and where there's one of each person represented and you have them all sketch design ideas to a solution. It can be sort of intimidating for them if they don't feel particularly visually inclined. But it's a great little tool. And we expected that this would give us some insight into, well, would make wireframing easier and prototyping easier and visual solutions easier, and it did. But even more importantly, it was unexpected, but it created this amazing sense of consensus building and team building, and people who might have the corner office, you know, and never come in contact with, say, you know, an entry-level developer, we're suddenly coming to consensus about the best way to solve a solution and seeing that someone might have an idea, oh, it would be amazing if we included a video how-to here, and someone else saying, wow, that is really great. So it was an amazing tool for consensus building. Finally, guide, recommend, and then move on. Very visually beautiful and completely abstract, absolutely stunning. Nobody knows how to use it. And that's kind of okay. We flagged tons of times that people didn't know how to use it. And the brand said, yeah, that's fine. And it's kind of okay at the end of the day because this brand is a very trendy, hip brand that's made its success and fortune on having people, being just a little bit cooler than everybody else. So it's kind of makes sense that the user doesn't really get it. So ultimately, sometimes they might be right. So this comes to our fourth challenge. So whatever big ideas you have about getting it right, there's probably not enough time to do it anyway. Of course, in a perfect world, done. But in the real world, when resources are limited, which is almost always the case, IA and UX are the first to go. So I recently spoke with two different kinds of organizations. One was a ginormous cultural institution that had tons and tons of content that they wanted to figure out how to share on the digital arena. And the other was a very small startup that had one digital product. The first team had about 100 people in it. The second team had about 30. In both cases, they were of developers and then marketing. So the other thing that these two very, very radically different organizations had in common was that neither one of them had a UX person or an IA person on staff. And they'd both make things, but it was the first thing to go when budgets got cut, when timing got cut, when deadlines were pressing, that was the first to go. So in this kind of environment where time is everything, time to market, timing, deadlines, budget, how do we advocate for UX? I love this slide, by the way. If you don't know what it is, it's a desire path, which is basically, there's the real road in the back, and then there are these desire paths, which are well known to urban planners as the paths that people actually really want to take. So there's like the official place and then the place where everyone else actually wants to go. So how do we advocate in a world where timing is everything for this kind of approach? Well, it definitely helps to have the support of management and to have it to have them show it from example and have it come from above. But there are other strategies you might need to incorporate. So this is a word on Agile. I think Agile has a lot of things to teach us and a lot of things we can take from it, and there are lots of parts of it that actually behoove a UX designer, the iteration, the testing, and so forth. But I also feel like on occasion it has the emphasis on tangible deliverables, the speed, etc., and the cross-disciplinary kind of ambiance that it sets up puts stress on UX designers. It can sometimes mean that UX gets folded into visual design or UX gets folded into development, and it doesn't always leave room for the more qualitative findings like the kind of work that Hana was talking about earlier with the customer journey. It's good to remember that not everything can be quantified. Not everything can be measured in numbers, which might be a little bit contradictory to what I was saying earlier in terms of leveraging statistics and data and user testing. And that's all true, but it's only a part of the picture. So in another example of a retail website, I don't know if you all know on Amazon, there's this little functionality when you're checking out which says save for later. So it kind of allows you to remove something, think about it, and not actually be forced to buy it. So this was an approach that I was recommending for its flexibility, for its ease of use, for just kind of good user experience. And the brand that I was speaking to said, yeah, well, if you put that in there, the order value is gonna be less. And I was like, yeah, but if you don't you want your users to be happy? You don't want to force them to buy things. And it turned out they were right. We did some informal user testing, and it turns out that if you put a button that says, save for later, people might actually sometimes use it. But I think this is a really good example of how, at the end of the day, the numbers and the statistics only tell you a part of the story. So, yeah, at not being able to remove something or quantify their happiness at having this flexibility. So I think that's an important consideration to take into account. Finally, I like to think of UX as the slow food of application design. If anybody knows slow food, or if they don't, it's what a lot of our farm to table and all of these sorts of movements, artisanal food things, are based on. It was started in the 80s in Italy in response, and just gives some basic good sense about healthy food and healthy eating habits. And in a way, I kind of think of user experience as the same kind of thing. We're trying to give, to add quality, slow people down, ask the difficult questions, and provide the solutions that are best adapted to them. So, in conclusion, our four challenges. No one knows what you do. No one knows what they need. They're not entirely sure they want your opinion, and there's probably not enough time anyway. So why on earth do this kind of work? Well, for one, it's a super exciting time right now. Even if a lot of people still don't know what we do, the field has gained a ton of recognition in the last couple of years. And for example, in the example that I gave of the two different teams, the cultural team and the startup, neither one had a UX person on staff, but they were both talking to me because they realized they needed one. So there are things to be done. Second, this is an image of mind control Pong, which is about as close as we've gotten so far to controlling things with our thoughts. So we've got a ways to go before we are completely seamless and interfaceless. And until then, interfaces are all around us. They're everywhere. They're, you know, in our pocket, in our computers, the way we socialize, in the fabrics we wear, on our wrist. They're everywhere. And with all of this pervasive computing, there are tons of interfaces, and they all need architecting. So there's a lot of work to do. So when Hana and I were talking about this presentation early on, one of the themes that came up, and I feel like I've heard it a little bit today too, is I and UX attract a certain kind of person. Organized, yes, but also curious and empathetic. We're problem solvers. We're intuitive and logical at the same time, and we're passionate about a lot of different things and finding solutions to different problems. So embrace the complexity. We're not here to, you know, coast. We're here to ask the difficult questions and propose potential solutions to problems. Embrace the complexity and the challenges and the obstacles. Evolve with it. Be open to change. Pull out the tool that works best in the context that you're in. And enjoy it. So I just wanted to end with a quote that sort of reflects the same spirit of where we came from today at the beginning of the talk, which is that most people talk about successes, and we're here to talk about some of the more complicated obstacles. And it just that it is by Richard Saul Wurman, who, if you obviously probably know that he is the founder of information architecture, but on top of that, he also founded the TED conference. And a couple of years ago, he won the Smithsonian Institution's Lifetime Achievement Award, and he said, you know, this is a really courageous choice. Usually people write books about their area of expertise, but I write books about the things I don't know. My books I do because I don't understand a subject, and the book is the journey from not knowing to knowing. I'm passionate about my ignorance. I'm passionate about filling up that black hole of ignorance to understand something. So I think this is something that we can all probably relate to, and yeah, that's it. Thank you very much.
Hi, everybody. How's everybody doing? All right, so we got a couple more things. We got more things to give away. Now there's free stuff. You stuck it out. You're here. You're still here. You saw some people speak. We're going to give you free stuff. There'll be time to mingle, talk to VSA, talk to whoever else is here. It's great. We're very excited. All right, if I go back to No. Mouse. All right, maybe now it'll work. Nope. There it is. Right, so that was them. Giveaways. All right. So there's one other thing that is, this first one isn't really a giveaway, but if you liked what you saw today, consider going to the not free Information Architecture Summit. It's taking place later this year in Atlanta. There is a code, WIAD50, that gets you $50 off the admission cost. You know, see if your work will send you to an information architecture conference. It's a lot of fun. I promise. I've been there before. I've had a good time. All right, so now we're going to try the drawings. We're going to see how this works. The first drawing is for a bunch of books. I have them in a box over there. The Understanding Group. They are a Grand Rapids, Michigan-based consulting group specializing in understanding and information architecture. If you happen to be in Grand Rapids, Michigan, you should look them up. It's a lovely town. They are lovely. Yeah. All right, so, and the books they're giving away are all things that have inspired them personally. And if I can do... Hey, this website is very big. See, look, it's everybody's name who signed up. Maybe it'll... Maybe your name will show up. Oh, my. This is difficult. All right, so we're gonna try this. When I click randomize, great. So Ron, you win the books. Come see me afterwards. This is, so Ron won the Tug books. Thank you, Ron. Very good. Very exciting. If I go back, cool. So we can just keep doing this. He might win again because it's random. That's the thing that nobody understands about truly random things. I'm just going to use these as notes and not put that back up again. All right, so that was Tug. Great. Sveta, who we saw speak earlier, is giving away a copy of her book, Sound Is Not Enough. And we will see who wins that. Randomize. Loren. Do you want it? Where'd you go? I put your name in here too. Yeah? Great, Loren wins. All right, the next drawing is for... the polar bear book. There's a bunch of these. So the first 10 people in this random list, come see me afterwards so I can write your name down and give you the instructions. We don't actually have the books because they didn't actually get mailed in time. The Polar Bear book is the information architecture book. It is a gift from O'Reilly Media. As you can see, you can get the book, you can get the digital book for free using the coupon card back at registration. Yeah, she's holding it up back there. Thank you very much. And they're giving away a bunch of copies of the physical book as well. And we can sort that out afterwards. All right, so randomize. There it goes. All right, so I can't read all this. This is great. So, right, we got Margalita, if she's here. We'll just, you know, Margalita, Corey Clark, Chris Novell, Ricardo Huang, Judy Siegel, Amy Silvers, Sandeep Sarda, Jessica Sciorra, Greg Solis, and Matt Peterson. If you heard your name and you happen to be here, come see me afterwards. I'll get your information down and tell you how to get your book from O'Reilly. All right, there's more. There's two more drawings. The next one is from Mach Plus. Let me look. So it is a license for their tool. It's great. You can find out more about it and what it is once you win. And the winner of the Mach Plus is Alexander Provo, if you're here. Oh, great. Congratulations. The next one is Azure, Exure is another tool for prototyping stuff. There's a lot of these. There's a huge competitive market. Maybe you have a prototyping tool you need to make. And Exure is giving away a license, and that license will go to Michelle Straw, if she's here. All right, no one's jumping. Janice Tsai. Everybody go. Xavier Anderson. We've now, there, Xavier gets it. That's great, because you know, maybe we generated a random list of people that don't exist. And there's one more. The very last giveaway is from one of our sponsors. It's Rosenfeld Media, and it is a digital copy of every book they have. I think this is like 30 or 40 books. We'll see who gets this one. All right, so if I go randomize, Richard D. Herring? No? All right. Mark. Fallon? All right. Nobody's jumping. Rick Sansone? Hey, Rick. All right. So if you won something in this amazing random thing, come see me afterwards and we'll talk about it. Great. So that was it. That was the show. Thanks again to all of our global sponsors, our local sponsors, you know, the Information Architecture Institute, and the volunteers. Thank you for helping out, make this all happen. Everybody's done a great job. And thank you all for coming out. You know, you spent your morning and early afternoon here listening about information architecture. So thank you so much for coming out. Please hang out, talk to each other. If you have questions for the speakers, there's more snacks if you want to eat them. Or, you know, go enjoy the beautiful day. Thank you all.